This presentation is focused on the hip and knee replacement surgery, and we were really looking at, could we address the wait time problem we have in Canada? Because, well, this is a hot topic at the time. We thought maybe we'll be more likely to get funded for it, in addition to improving the quality of the decisions. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first talk about, we had to re-change that process of care and look at standardizing the screening process. We then want to evaluate what happened to patients seen in the program in the first year of that new revised approach. And then we want to look at, did the decision aid work and how did it work? So we, at the Ottawa Hospital, because I was part of it as a researcher, set up the Orthopedic Intake Clinic, and it was launched in December of 2006. And at that time, it was staffed with musculoskeletal physicians or sports med physicians. And the reason we chose physicians is because then they could bill for the service. And so we didn't have to have an infrastructure to pay a nurse or a physiotherapist for doing this assessment. Part of our standardized process that we implemented when we set up the new clinic is we had all the patients fill in the WOMAC scale around the hip, and it's around pain, impact on physical function, and stiffness. We also wanted to make sure that the sports med physicians were doing a standardized assessment that we could look at how bad are the patients coming in through this clinic and guide them in who should be going on to see the surgeon versus who should go back to primary care for better management of their osteoarthritis. And so we ended up choosing the tool that came from the Western Canada Waitlist Project on hips and knees. And in this tool, the first is, so this is an assessment done by that sports med physician or a nurse or a physio. So pain on motion or on bending, so level one is none and level four is really severe. Pain at rest, causing sleep disturbance, ability to walk without significant pain, other functional limitations, threat to patient's role or independence, X-ray examination abnormal findings, and then was the X-ray normal or abnormal. We then mapped, this is actually our assessment tool that goes into the patient's health record, because we mapped it onto the NIH, the National Institutes of Health clinical practice guidelines for hip and knee replacement that said that in order to have surgery, you need to have moderate to severe pain, at least one functional criteria rated as moderate to severe, and an abnormal X-ray. And these were meant to be guidance, not absolute, but sort of to help guide who went on to see the surgeon versus back to primary care. These are the criteria from the National Institutes of Health around for knee replacement surgery. So we had sports med physicians on our team and orthopedic surgeons on the team and researchers, and one of the sports med physicians had a student that needed a project. So we said, oh, well, why don't you go back and evaluate the first year of patients in through the clinic and see what happens to them. So one of the first things that she found in the 327 patients that came through this new clinic we set up is that most patients were using analgesics or non-steroidal anti-inflammatories and pretty much nothing else. And so they weren't really trying very many options in terms of managing it. So the other options are cortisone, injections, physiotherapy, bracing, glucosamine, which actually I don't think has any evidence, weight loss, surgery, other types of surgery. And other was things like acupuncture, exercise, massage. So what happened to these 327 patients? Half were actually referred back to their family physician because they actually didn't even have OA bad enough to warrant consideration of surgery. And the other half went on to see the surgeon. And of those that saw the surgeon, 81% had surgery. And 19% had no surgery because they had other health issues that interfered with them going on to surgery. It was the patient's decision that they went to see the surgeon, but they really didn't want surgery. Or the symptoms resolved, which kind of leads to, I'm not sure what happened in our process, but some people push their way through that process. We also looked at what was the mean age, those that were female, their BMIs, medications tried. There's no difference between groups. But where we saw differences is as those that went on to see the surgeon were more likely to have had some kind of injections. They tried three or more different measures for getting pain relief. They met the NIH criteria, so you can see here where they're more likely to, not 100%, but most met them. They had higher WOMAC scores, and they had higher scores on the hip-knee priority tool. So this priority tool was actually originally developed by Tom Noseworthy in the group to prioritize who should go to surgery faster or slower, and it's never been used in the way it's been used. So I've talked to him a couple times about how we're using it as a standardized assessment as opposed to priority setting. So what we found is that there's huge underuse of conservative measures prior to referral to the surgeon. The use of a sports med physician and these screening tools resulted in a 50% reduction in surgical consultations. Most patients referred on to the surgeon got surgery. And patients with milder OA need better management in the community, because what happens is they come in, they complain to their family physician, and the main next step in the process is an orthopedic surgeon. And the orthopedic surgeons think that they've come to see me because they want surgery. Like there's, and so really, there's a mismatch in our system around how these patients are being supported. So I've also done work with the Saskatchewan, and Saskatchewan's also set up these clinics, and also at some of the other hospitals in Ottawa. But what they've done is they've put a nurse, a practitioner, or a physiotherapist as the person doing these standardized assessments, because you don't have to have a physician doing that assessment. So the next step is we were also evaluating the effectiveness of the patient decision aid. So the first thing we did is we went out to look for a decision aid that we liked that already existed, and we chose the one from the Informed Medical Decisions Foundation because it hadn't been evaluated in a randomized trial. But one of the things that we liked about theirs, they have really nicely produced decision aids, but it comes with a video, so it really reaches those with lower literacy, and also written materials in a book. We also, in this project, created the one-page summary for the surgeon so that it reported on the patient's WOMAC score. So you can see here where this patient has moderate pain, moderate to severe pain, limited function, stiffness. Their scores from the hip-knee priority tool is moderate for most things and severe for their physical exam. Their ability to walk, they can walk more 1 to 5 blocks. So their walking isn't quite as limited. They prefer to have a knee replacement surgery. They feel sure about their choice. They've scored, in the first version of knowledge questions, we only had 4, but in the validated version now there's 5. But you can see here where they didn't realize that full recovery takes more than 6 months. And so they were expecting, like any kind of surgery, within a couple weeks I'll be up running around and I'll have a new knee, so I'll actually be 100% back to normal. Their value, 97% of their values predicted their surgical preference. And you can see here, reasons for surgery strongly outweighs reasons against surgery. So when the surgeon looks at this form, if it's Jeff Durbin, one of the surgeons that's on this project with me, they have concerns around side effects. It's pretty clear this patient meets the criteria above for the severity of their disease. They have good knowledge, so they'll correct the knowledge. It's pretty clear that they're favoring surgery over non-surgery, but they have concerns here. So what he then goes on to talk about is, within our program, this is the medications we use to prevent blood clots, these are the antibiotics we use, this is sort of the way the routine works to help you become successful with having the surgery. But what's nice is he's allowed to talk about those success things because the patient's already come with that knowledge. It's clear they want surgery and moving forward. And so this one-page summary we actually published in BMJ in 2008 as we were using it within this clinic. The only thing that's different from the 2008 is we added on BMI because the surgeon said we really need that as the other bit of information on our form. So in our study, we are just in the process of submitting this one. We had 167 in each arm of hips and knees. The average age was 66 years, men and women. We reached people with less than high school education, which was nice because the other paper that was published by Bosek in San Francisco, it was all really highly educated patients, and so the critique on it that was written and published in the journal was that you're dealing with people in a very elite class. So I'm happy we got lower education. They had some lived alone, and then in terms of employment, you can see there's a range. Most are retired, and we also reached a range of incomes, people with less than 20,000 a year to over 100,000 a year. And I have the numbers I could share, but thought it's just more important we had a range. So our first, we're busy thinking we're going to improve wait times. And when we design the study, we're actually going to design it to 100% of patients referred into that clinic. And so if you think about it, 50% were sent back to primary care. And if they were in this study, we would have had a huge improvement on wait times. But we were actually already synthesized out those going for surgery that were exposed to, in the study, to the decision aid. And so it wasn't statistically significant, but there is fewer wait time for patients that get the decision aid versus those that were in the usual care group. And part of this is the patients are supported in making this decision and come to their decision much more solidly. And we actually have a quote from a patient that said, you know, I just felt really solid about my decision going forward in this one. So, but there's no statistically significant difference. We showed an improvement in decision quality scores. So this measure was taken prior to seeing the surgeon. So 56% reached a decision knowledge score over 66%, and their values predicted their choice of either choosing surgery or not choosing surgery. It depended on what they preferred compared to usual care. The patients, some were still pretty feeling unsure about the best option because they wanted to meet the surgeon first. And we know that you're actually probably only going to score 4 out of 4 on the SURE test after you meet the surgeon, because that's when you sort of feel, okay, now I'm ready to make that decision with the surgeon. In terms of the decision, you can see where we had fewer surgeries in the decision aid group compared to usual care, but it wasn't statistically significantly different. And then we followed patients for 2 years in the study, because we were able to look at who looped back to have surgery at a later point, and there was no significant difference between groups. Because what our fear is that we're just pushing people later, which may not be a bad thing, though, in osteoarthritis because of having to have repeat surgeries like after 15 to 20 years, but we wanted to make sure that we weren't just turning people off and delaying them coming back later. In terms of the process of decision making, if you look at the IPDAS standards for process, we improved knowledge. They felt more informed. They were more significantly more clear about their values, and you can see how they scored over the usual care group. No difference in feeling supported or feeling sure between the groups, but as I mentioned, this SURE was measured before seeing the surgeon. It helped them prepare, know the decision depends on values, and prepare to talk to the doctor, and then no difference in recognizing a decision needs to be made, because even this group, they were stimulated to know a decision was being made just by answering our survey questions. So there appeared to be a shorter wait for patients in the patient decision aid group that also had the preference report for the surgeon compared to usual care. The patient decision aid group had significantly higher decision quality. They felt more informed, more clear about what mattered most, prepared to discuss their values for outcomes of options with the surgeon, and knew the decision depended on what mattered to them. Overall, patient decision aids improved that process of decision making, resulted in higher quality. And we're not aiming to decrease surgical rates in Ottawa, because when we look at our practice variation, we're not quite as bad. Well, you have to wait a year for surgery in Ottawa, so I think part of it is we're not probably as bad as in some of the practice variation in the U.S. That's the last slide.
Thank you very much for a series of wonderful presentations. Does anyone have any specific questions about the hip and knee study? Amanda?
Thanks so much. I have a specific question which could be applied to other areas as well, but more about the at the beginning of your first presentation about Obamacare and sort of legislative changes with elective surgery, actually, shared decision making having to be part of the process in some states. So what influence do you think, when we're talking about the levers for change, that pilot
So in Canada, we don't have that high-level leverage, other than in Saskatchewan, where we're actually implementing in hip and knee. And they're actually mailing the decision aid out to the patients before the consult, because the patients travel long distances to see to come in for an assessment. And at that assessment, if they're deemed appropriate, they then also see the surgeon on that visit. But they don't. If it turns out in the assessment that really seeing the surgeon isn't the best option for them, then they don't see the surgeon. The surgeons are happy with that because it means they're only seeing those that are really serious about having surgery. So in Canada, we don't have the same leverage. In the U.S., since the Obama legislation came out, I get a lot of emails from health plans and healthcare organizations And most of the time they're asking for permission to use the Ottawa Personal Decision Guide as a generic tool for all decisions, because that way they have a tool in their organization that they can have coverage for all decisions. And so what I've noticed over the last 4 years is this huge demand for access to that tool, which is available free of charge on our website. Like, anybody can download it. We can send you the PDF of it or a Word document. We ask that it not be, and sometimes they change the title of it to reflect their organization, but giving credit to ours for the actual documents. We just ask that they don't change the content of the tool. Mm-hmm. So I don't have good, that's the biggest evidence that I see that legislation has really changed this desire in the U.S. to have some evidence of shared decision making on the patient's health record.
Any other questions? Well, we will just wrap up at this stage the videoing and the formal presentation. Dawn, thank you again so much for your enormous workload and willingness to share this information with us, and for some fantastic presentations and some fantastic workshops that we've had. So I very much appreciate you coming and doing that.
Thank you.
So much.